vivid piece, man.
Everything starts with an E.
We had this Everything Starts With an E, which was a sample from Ronald McDonald, believe it or not. And I just had this sample for ages, and I thought it was quite amusing. And then when that whole ecstasy thing, I don't know whether I should say this on camera, but when that whole thing came along, it was like a slang for that drug, and that even made it really funny. So I thought, I've got to use this in a song. So I did this sort of 12 bars blues kind of music, and then the punchline was Everything Starts With an E. Played it to George and he just fell about laughing. He thought it was great and he said, come on, we're going in the studio. And I said, well, look, all we've got is the music and the punchline, you know. He said, doesn't matter, we'll make it as we go along. So we hired some grotty studio in Willesden or something, and I was walking around with a megaphone, like shouting at Samantha Fox through the window and stuff. It was a really wild session. And so basically, we just made it out as we went along. We got Karen in at the last minute, which is MC Kinky, who did a brilliant job toasting on that, who's got a wild style voice. And she kind of made the record, and we edited it up all round her, and that was it. Story. That's how the label started. We sold it to Virgin. They were like, yeah, let's do some more. And they financed it after that.
The involvement I have is just choosing what I want to put out on it and the people that I sign. That's it, really. I suppose A&R. But again, I have to go through other people at Virgin. I have to say, look, I really think this is a good idea. So it's constantly, you know, selling things to them as well. It's not really, at the end of the day, my decision. But so far, I don't have anything on it that I don't want. And at the moment, it's quite incestuous because a lot of the people are friends of mine and people I know quite well. So it's, it's pretty family at the moment.
I mean, basically, you know, the More Protein label is about, like, dance music, and it's primarily about that. If we have hits, then all well and good, but it's got to be successful in that environment first, I think.
You and George go back to the Hazy Fantasy days, don't you?
Even before then, actually. We met on a bus going to school. I was about 14, he was about 15. I remember it was on the top floor, I was walking along, and George was sitting on the back seat, and he goes, you know, I like your shoes, because I had these really dirty, great big brothel creepers on, really awful shoes. He goes, I like your shoes. I go, I like your hair. And then we started becoming friends. That's how we met. He was going to one school, I was going to another one. So we go way back. And I started my band Hazy Fantasy. He started Culture Club. And we kind of fell out because there was like, oh, he's doing the dreadlocks idea. You know, there's only a few ideas going round at certain times. Of course, because we were very new to the game, it was like, oh, you know, he's doing that idea, so I can't do it. And it got very precious, and then the press got hold of it, and they love stirring things up, you know. If you say anything bad about anybody, it's like big news in the press. So they stirred it up, and we fell out for about 3 or 4 years, I think, which was awful. But we got back together again, and it was nice.
The sun machine is coming down. We're gonna have a party. Hey, hey, hey.
Well, still a bit busy. Yeah, I DJ at a place called The Quiet Storm tonight, which is Friday. And for that. And another club called Subterranea, which I do every Saturdays, which is just under the Westway in West London, which is fun. I really like that. I really enjoy DJing. I've started again 6 months ago, and it's getting really popular again now. So I do as much as I can. It's also a great education for making dance records. It's almost like, for a musician playing live, you notice what works with an audience, what turns people on. And it's the same with dance music. That's why there's so many successful DJs making successful dance records, because you know what's going on, you can see it.
Just doing it right. How can I do?
also doing quite a lot of remixing.
Yeah, I've just done The Clash, Guns Brixton. You'll probably check that one out pretty soon, which is quite a hardcore thing. That was just through my friend Paul. He's a bass player. He actually wrote that. And of course, you know, it was Dub Be Good To Me is like the sample is actually his sample. So he said, well, look, they've sampled my record. And I said, well, let's go and do a remix, put it out again. And he was like, yeah, man, let's do it. So that's fun. We're going to do some more tracks, some of the old Clash stuff, I think. It's like going to be called Club Clash and do a whole album of it. So that's an ongoing project. I've done Shakespeare's Sister, which is a heavily requested record on the pirate radio stations. That track called Dirty Mind got banned from Radio 1, so all the pirates love it. And I did a hardcore mix of that. God, so many things. I've just done a band called Mano Negro, which is a big band in France. And that should be coming out soon, which has turned out really well as well. That's about it for the moment.
Vivid.
Hi, this is Bob Geldof. You're watching Vivid.
Hi, my name's George, and Jesus loves you, don't you know it?
After the love is gone.
The mainstream music scene is a bit like the 50s. You've got your Kylies, who's basically Doris Day, Jason is Fabian. You've got all these sort of artists that, I mean, most of the artists on record companies are very sort of squeaky clean, you know, very clean. I mean, it's not what you call rock and roll. You know, it's a whole, it's just different. I don't know. It's certainly different to when Culture Club started. You know, I mean, I was talking to you before about my record company last year, you know, saying that, because I've had, obviously, since my drug problems, I've had a lot of problems in America, and you know, the record companies, being the geniuses that they are, coming up with all these ideas about how to break, you know, in record companies, everybody wants to be the one to break the ex-superstar back into the charts in America. So they're all sort of coming up with these ideas about what I should and shouldn't do, you know, and who I should work with. And I've, in the last few years, I've been through a lot of that. I mean, I did some music with a guy called Teddy Riley, which was a bit of a disaster for me. I mean, I got a top five black record out of it in America, but personally, it was a bit of a disaster. And I listened to the record company over that. So I'm at the stage now where I just want to do what I want to do, and I think I know what I'm doing. You know, I mean, I could be wrong. I could be mad.
Some kids on a sweet 16 think they're really tough.
Having been really successful with Culture Club and been, you know, sort of, you know, media darling and stuff like that, that, you know, you're constantly being referred to everything, you know, that you've done in the past, which is a bit of a drag. But as far as I'm concerned with Jesus Loves You, I'm a new group. I just see it like that. I'm a totally new group. I'm starting out from scratch. That's how I'm looking at it, you know, and I think that one of the things that I have achieved, which I hadn't achieved since Culture, well, I didn't even achieve it in Culture Club, is that people are actually coming up to me saying, I like your record, you know, I mean, it's sort of, you know, after The Love, it sold about 55,000 copies in England, which is really good. You know, but the only unfortunate thing about that is that it sold, well, not unfortunate, I'm really happy about that, but it sold through club shops, you know, most of them aren't Gallup. And it sold for over a long period of time, you know, and it did more good for me than anything I've done before, because it was a liked record, you know, in the clubs, people liked it. And that's what I want. I'm more concerned about my credibility than my record sales.
After the love is gone, how can we carry on? After the love is gone, how can we carry on?
Well, what happened was that we wrote some songs together, and they were good, you know, and I enjoyed it, but when we recorded them, I didn't think they stood up, really. So I just said, look, I think we should leave it for now. And plus, during that period, I'd started to work on my Jesus Loves You project. And I'd written quite a lot of stuff with this guy in Sheffield called Mark Bryden. and I just liked it much more. It was more, I think, more subtle. I think the problem with Culture Club was that we were an 80s pop band, you know, and I'm over 80s pop.
It was apparent that we'd all changed quite significantly, and it wasn't right. So we recorded a few tracks. They were good, but they weren't right, so we decided to leave it. There's no point in doing something unless it's absolutely right. I mean, I know when something's got X factor, when something hits it, when it feels good, and it just wasn't quite right. You know, and George has got a lot of different projects on, a little bit frenetic, shall we say. So all in all, I mean, I just decided I wanted to get on with something else because I found that, you know, relying on the past or relying on Culture Club is a dangerous trap, you know. I mean, it would be nice to do it. I mean, Culture Club was like my baby in a way. I was very, very upset. It's untimely demise. But, you know, it's okay. It's the way it goes.
It would have been better if we just stopped, like, at Karma Chameleon. But, you know, it's so difficult to stop. You know, it's like in a relationship, you know, when you're infatuated with somebody and everything, but, you know, it's not really working. You know that it's not going to go any further than it is, but you can't bear to let go. That's how I look at Culture Club. It was like, you know, because you're sort of, you know, you get so used to that whole sort of lifestyle. You think, what will happen if I stop this band? And it's a brave decision to make. I admire people that do it. You know, I admire, in a way, George Michael for splitting up Wham, you know, and The Jam and things like that. It is definitely the best attitude to take, but we just didn't have the strength to do it, fortunately. With drugs, it's a very difficult sort of subject because it's impossible to tell people not to do them. You know, you can only say, look, you know, I did and this happened to me, or you can say there is light at the end of the tunnel, which is the other thing, you know. I'm about to open a vegetarian restaurant called Vada the Dish. I'd like to open one of those. I think there's not very many good vegetarian restaurants in London. There's lots of things I'd like to do, you know. Like, I'd like to open a restaurant with a cafe so people could sit in it. I don't think there's enough places where people can communicate in this town anymore.